is interactive, which is just absolutely the worst thing when they're in the audience, so I apologize. How many people have heard of mogul skiing, seen it, or encountered a mogul on a ski slope? Okay, solid, actually. That's excellent. I did not expect that. Okay, I was a mogul skier. Mogul skiing is two jumps executed as well as you possibly can execute them with the highest degree of difficulty, and then navigate a bunch of bumps in between. It's pretty simple, and do it as fast as you possibly can. So it's judged, but it's also timed. And it's super fun. This is my story of 20 years as a skier and the data that I produced during that 20 years and how that data helped me reach the top of the sport. I was incredibly intimidated when I looked at this program because I do not have a PhD, I don't know that much about sports science, and I'm not even very tech savvy. Which will be apparent when you see my effort at a PowerPoint. I do, however, have experience being an athlete that produces the data. I'm one of the athletes that all of you are trying to help. So I first just want to say thank you. 13 years in the US ski team, I took it all for granted. Help me, I'll trust you, help me get better. I did not understand all of the research, the time, the energy, and the passion that went into helping me be the best that I could. So on behalf of, I don't know, all the athletes in the entire world, thank you very, very much. Okay, let's back it up. 1986, February, I was born in a town called Norwich, Vermont. It's a tiny town, less than 4,000 people, maybe even less than 3,000 people in a given year. And it's a quintessential New England town in the northeast part of the United States with a main street that has a post office and a bakery and a bank. And my elementary school, and a church, all pictured right there. That house is the house that I grew up in, and my dad built it with his bare hands. Growing up, I had a very normal childhood. I think my parents tried to give me every opportunity they possibly could with the salaries of a carpenter and a recreation director. My parents taught me how to ski when I was just 2 years old, because what else are you gonna do in Vermont in the long, dark, cold winters? It was a family activity. Man, did I have good style back then. When I learned how to ski, my parents put my body in a horse halter, pushed me down the slopes. I actually don't remember learning how to ski. And I think that's one of the unique things about the Olympic sport of skiing. I guarantee every bobsledder remembers their first time down a bobsled track. I don't remember learning the sport that I went on to become an Olympian in. And I was drawn to those bumps at a very early age after I was released from the horse halter and the lead line that was my learning device. Once I was free on my own, I was always drawn to the bumps that formed naturally on the side of the slopes, the cut-throughs through the trees that the old people had to duck under. I would just scoot through. I thought of it as a fun obstacle course. And so my dad saw my love of navigating those bumps, and he built me a jump in the backyard. I think we could probably have an entire other conversation and presentation about the old 10,000-hour rule, whether it's myth or fact, but let's just say at a young age, without goggles, apparently, I was practicing. But it wasn't practice. To me, that was just fun. That was a fun way to spend evenings since my dad set up a light. And I think from this picture, you probably will not be shocked to learn that my brother is actually a semi-professional hockey player, because these are hockey sticks that are outlining the jump. We were a really sporty family. While I was learning to ski and pursuing skiing, I also tried other sports. And by tried, I meant my mom forced me to. She bribed me with a pair of soccer shorts if I tried one soccer practice, and with a pair of running shoes if I entered a track meet. Both of those experiences resulted in one day, and I was hooked. My competitive drive, I think that I won the 50-meter dash, but got second in the 100, and I was like, I was maybe eight. I'm like, that's not cutting it. I'm coming back for more. And all three of those sports, I pursued all the way through high school after being bribed into trying them. But the rule there was that I just had to try it. My parents did not pressure me. If I didn't like it, I got to quit. But I was instantly hooked. Keeping in mind at this time, I was just skiing for fun. So I had no competitive outlet. And that's what I found in soccer and track. But because I loved the competition so much, I thought I'm going to try a skiing competition. And at age 9, I entered my first freestyle skiing competition. It used to be moguls, aerials, and ballet skiing, but we'll focus on the mogul aspect. Again, I was hooked instantly after not winning every single event that I entered and thought, I would like to beat all of these people that just beat me. And so I continued with all three of these sports throughout my normal childhood. When I was 12, I qualified for a competition right here in Utah. And it was the first time that I was going to have to buy a plane ticket to compete. And that was a financial burden for a carpenter and a recreation director. So at that point, I started writing letters to local businesses. I got sponsorships from local companies. I applied for grants. And I even caught the attention of a philanthropist who happened to be the father of someone who served on the recreation council with my mother. And he ultimately funded the majority of my career until I made the U.S. ski team. Because I was able to travel and had support, I caught the eye of the U.S. ski team coaches. And I will never forget the moment that I was studying for my sophomore year Algebra 2 midterm, and I got a phone call. And the phone call was a ski team coach saying, "You've probably heard next month the Winter Olympics are being held in Salt Lake City, Utah." I said, "Yes, I have heard that." They said, "We would like you to come forerun." I instantly burst into tears, tears of joy. This is a huge honor. Forerunners don't get to compete for a medal in the games, but you get to wear a bib with the Olympic rings on it. You get to ski on the same course as the best male and female mogul skiers in the entire world. I'd never even seen a competition of that level. And now here I was out there on the same venue as these athletes. It was a really eye-opening, exciting, incredibly intimidating experience. But I did my run. I made my way down the course, the first one down, so the judges got to practice scoring and made sure the timing was right. And I thought it was a decent run. But the rest of the day, I got to watch the best female mogul skiers in the world compete for their country and win Olympic medals. And I was like, boy, they are fast. They're strong. The tricks they are doing are way better than anything I have in my repertoire. That's really impressive. They're good. But they're not that good. And I all of a sudden saw what it took to be the best. I'm like, oh, this is it? That's it. That's literally the best mogul skier in the world. I think I can do that. I at least saw what it was going to take. And so I went home. And it happened to be February vacation. So I had a week off of school. And I got to focus exclusively on skiing. I learned a new trick. I didn't learn it properly. I rushed it. But I had seen what those women were doing at the top level. And I knew that I was going to have to do it if I wanted to be there. It's pretty simple. Okay, learn that trick. And the next two competitions, I competed that trick. I happened to land it and ski away. And one of those competitions was Junior Worlds. So 2 weeks after my 16th birthday, I earned my spot on the U.S. ski team. And that's, I guess, where this story actually starts. That was the introduction. For the rest of high school, I balanced a career on the U.S. ski team, competing on the World Cup circuit, the highest level of sport. I was competing against those athletes I had seen compete at the 2002 Olympics. But I also excelled in triple jump and long jump. Excellent cross-training for a power sport, and I played soccer. I was the captain of my soccer team my senior year. I also photocopied a lot of textbooks and brought them with me on the road, so it was a stressful time, but it taught me a lot about time management. When I graduated high school, I was a national champion, and I had a 3.97 GPA because that damn algebra exam, the night after I got that phone call, I tanked because I spent the whole night being crying and being excited, and I'm still upset about that A-. Anyway, I've let it go, so I swear. My hometown, when I graduated, I thought, okay, obviously, the Olympics are just one season away. I'm just going to focus on skiing. I want to go to the Olympic Games. That's the goal as an elite athlete. And at 19, I qualified for the games. My wonderful hometown sent me off on this bandstand that was pictured in that first picture you saw. The whole town came out onto the green. All the school children got out of school. They sang songs to me and played the national anthem for me and sent me off. It was touching, but it was also felt like a lot of pressure. All of a sudden, yes, I'd been competing at World Cups. No one was really paying attention to those. Now, everyone was paying attention. And they meant to be supportive, and they were, but it added some pressure. And I was 19, and I didn't know exactly how to handle that. So I thought, I'm just going to block out everything else, and I'm going to treat the Olympics like a regular competition. The athletes are the same. The judges are the same. The course is the same. Ultimately, that would mean you just need the same skills to win. That was my mental philosophy going into the Olympic Games. But That didn't go very well for me. I had physical symptoms of nerves once I got to the Torino Olympics, because it turns out you can't treat something that is the Olympics like it isn't the Olympics, because it's the Olympics. Does that make sense? So it didn't work for me. I got third to last place. In retrospect, it's going to ruin everyone's lunch. In retrospect, it makes sense that I got third to last place, of course. At the time, it just felt heartbreaking. This was an era before the beautiful Center of Excellence that I think many of you got to see yesterday. It was actually before we had a strength and conditioning coach specifically for the mogul team, and it was certainly before I was a focused, specifically trained athlete. I have a feeling I was playing too much water polo, not lifting enough weights, and I had a really bad attitude. And you say, how can you remember that? That was so long ago. I'll tell you how I can remember that. Because here is my handwritten journal entry from August 2004. This is when the start of my data collection began. I have so many of these notebooks in my house because from this day forward, I kept track of everything I did in my training till the day I retired in 2015. But that's getting ahead of myself. So let me just take you back to an 18-year-old Hannah at a training camp in South America while we're on snow. And this is the second week I ever started keeping this journal. On August 26th, 2004, I'd graduated high school and I'm at this training camp. Apparently I had, quote, the worst training day ever. A bunch of backseat tee sets and then 45 minutes of brutal water polo and a giant loss by my team, apparently. The next day, I did a front flip. I over-rotated and out-jumped the landing. I ragdolled and I double-scorpioned. For those of you not familiar with skiing jargon, that's not good. That's a bad landing. It is, and just one last, because I can't help myself here. On August 28th, we had a day off, and I, quote, did shit and felt worthless. It's a miracle that at the end of that season, I became a world champion. It's not surprising that my results leading into that competition were inconsistent at best. It's also not surprising, looking at that data, that I did not perform the best I possibly could at the Torino Games the next season. It's also not surprising that 1 year after my failure at the Torino Games, I hit a mogul too hard, did not fall, but probably hyperextended my knee, and my ACL snapped. I spent my 21st birthday back home, Vermont, with my parents on crutches and painkillers. It was pretty devastating. At all those moments, I was thinking, I probably should have just gone to college like all of my friends did. They seem to be having fun. This isn't really that fun for me. But throughout the rehab process, I became a totally different athlete. And this is where data started playing a more and more significant role in my career. I genuinely enjoyed being home, not living out of my suitcase, having a break from my teammates, from that competitive environment. I adopted this sweet 7-year-old Rhodesian Ridgeback named Lola, and I started to spend a lot more time in the gym. I had an awful lot of help from the surgeon, of course, physical therapists, sports scientists, and strength and conditioning coaches helping me come back from this injury. I also had an attitude shift because a sport that I literally don't remember learning how to do was taken away from me. So from the first time in my life, I couldn't participate in skiing. Well, that certainly made me miss it, and I became much more grateful for the opportunities that skiing had actually provided for me in my life. Through the process of the rehab, I became obsessed every morning with waking up and trying to grow the girth of my quad, try to increase the number of sets, try to increase the degree of my range of motion, and try to increase the amount of weight I was lifting. This was the point in time when the numbers to me were providing evidence that I was improving, and I really bought into that. It also made me trust the programs, because numbers don't lie. I trusted the trainers providing them and helping me writing the programs to help me improve, because I was getting stronger. So they were right, it was working. I believed the data. And despite not having skied in a year, when I returned to competition, I was a far better competitor. I was stronger physically, obviously, because I'd put in the work, and I was stronger mentally, because I knew that I had put in the work. And it was a little inconsistent at first coming back, anything you've taken a long break from. But this was also the same period, we in Olympic sports, we talk in Olympic cycles. So from the cycle between my failure in Torino and the Vancouver 2010 games, this was also the time the ski team got on board. We hired a strength coach. His name was Alex Moore, and he had an immense impact on my career. We started using something called the ski team, called Visual Coaching Pro. So even though I was 2,000 miles away from this beautiful, beautiful center of excellence, I established a relationship with a trainer who was based there. I was 2,000 miles away. He would write a workout for me. I would do the workout. And then at the end of every day, I would fill out a diary. This diary included things such as how many hours of sleep I got, and then a number assignment for my mood, my energy levels, my soreness, my fatigue, my average heart rate. I added things like how many calories I burned. Of course, he saw the reps and sets of every exercise I'd done. This became my life. My life was data collection and filling out these diaries. I included things such as spent the afternoon pressing apples. Boy, I love the fall. I included things like my rolling pin broke tonight when I was making pasta, so I had to hand roll it, and I ended up with a bunch of giant worms as my pasta. That didn't work well. It didn't taste good, and I included a photo. So Alex Moore knew me better than anyone else in my life because I was living alone by myself in an isolated training environment. He became my confidant digitally, and I actually didn't know anything about him. It was a one-way relationship. This is the same time that testing started playing a role in my training. So twice a year, I would make the trip out here to Park City, Utah, to the Center of Excellence, and I would run through lactate threshold tests, body composition tests, and strength tests. These tests, okay, yeah, it's fun to watch your numbers improve, but what they did is give me confidence. So I'm 2,000 miles away. I'm on a trail run in Vermont trying to maintain a heart rate at 180 for 10 minutes. This is my second bout at 10 minutes, and boy, do I feel like I'm going to die. And I'm by myself. Maybe Lola's with me, and I definitely want to quit and start walking. I could come up with a million reasons. Oh, it looks a little unstable. I don't want to roll my ankle. Oh, my heart might actually explode. If I'm dead, I can't win an Olympic medal. Okay, but the data proved that 180 is the heart rate I have to be at to improve the best that I, to become the best that I can be. That is the optimal heart rate for me, and so I pushed on. And then I recorded that number and that entry in my diary, including the fact that I wanted to die, but that I did it. So all of that gave me an immense amount of confidence in the programs and then in myself, ultimately. So for the 3 years, again, Olympic cycles, going into 2010, skiing had been my full-time job. That was what I was focused on. And it turns out at this point in my career, that was a far better training program than just playing soccer. So I go into 2010 Olympics. Again, I qualify, which is a hard enough task on a team that's very, very competitive. And I'm feeling really, really good. I decided to do everything the exact opposite of what I had done in 2006 because you can't really get much worse than third to last place. So I'm like, I'm just going to do everything the opposite. I packed all red, white, and blue clothing, really embraced the opportunity that everyone's paying attention to this event, and I figured I'm at least going to enjoy it because third to last place was not pleasant. So if I'm going to get third to last place again, let me at least have fun along the way. So to me, the pressure was off because I had failed. And the sun had still come up, and I had lived to train for another day. So it was going to be okay. My hometown and my family still loved me despite my failure. And that sounds unrealistic, but that's what it felt like when I failed, was that it was over. My life was over, and no one was going to love me again. And it's not that I felt like I deserved to win the 2010 Olympics, but I couldn't think of any reason that I shouldn't. And that is that's the confidence that all of that data gave me. When I walked into the opening ceremonies in 2010, which you can guess I did not do in 2006 because our event was the next day, I didn't want to waste my energy standing on concrete for hours just to walk in a silly ceremony. Well, when I walked into that opening ceremony stadium with the rest of the American teammates all wearing our ridiculous outfits and hearing the cheers of the crowd, I have never to this day felt more like an Olympian. And I'd like to think I took that energy and carried it over to the very next day. But when I woke up the very next day, it was pouring rain, and I had a headache. I'm like, oh gosh, this is not how I wanted my Olympic experience to go. But Alex Moore, again, who was there, did a perfect job distracting us. He took us on a walk in the rain. We had a jump roping competition. And then I spent the rest of the morning playing a board game called Sequence that legitimately made me go cross-eyed from looking at it for so long. He also handed a card to each of the four female mogul skiing teammates. And I opened my card in the privacy of my room, and this is what was inside. It said, "Dear Hannah, since May," and then blah, 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 blah. You can read that. It was a laundry list of the work I had put in. It was the compilation of all my diary entries I had done in the off season, just that 1 year to prepare for this moment, this Vancouver, this moment for redemption. And it wasn't until years later that I learned this is not what was in everyone else's card. I just assumed he had taken a laundry list of data and put it in everyone's card. And this is why Alex was good, a good trainer. He knew that I spoke data, I was fluent in it, and this was motivating to me. He also knew that not all my teammates did. In fact, I don't even think they were filling out their diaries. That's a whole different story. And so to them, it was probably some inspirational moment, how note about how he believed in them. That was not going to help me ski well. I wanted to see the facts of why I could ski well. And that's exactly what he provided. So I got dropped off at the Olympic venue. It was still pouring rain. The first person I saw was my father. For the next 6 hours, he did not move from that spot. And this was what unfolded.
And Aiko Yamura right now, your top three competitors, with the number one qualifier, Hannah Kearney, set to drop in. The 23-year-old from Norwich, Vermont, looking for a bit of redemption when she did not qualify for the final 4 years ago in Torino. Your final competitor in women's moguls final. Will it be Hannah Kearney or Jen Heil taking home the gold? Clean so far off the top, and watch this middle section all week, flawless, ripping this middle section. So powerful and so tight.
Oh, look at the hands, Johnny. She is in the zone.
She is in the zone. Oh, and that's the heli she needed. She made one small mistake on that in qualifications and still was in fourth, and that's the fastest time. She has the whole package. The turns. Time. In the air, 827 feet of near perfection. Let's look at it again. Coming into the top kicker. I mean, so tight even right there. It's so powerful. Backflip, layout, clean. She backed off a lot of her difficulty and just focused on execution because her skiing is so good. Here she comes with the perfect turns through the middle. And at her speed, skiing faster than everyone else to keep it this tight. This is textbook skiing, and just sets that heli big and floats it for the judges to see. Check it. And that was big, I can tell, because she landed almost in the moguls.
As the scores come down, she's done it! American Hannah Kearney wins gold! And she will extend the Canadian home gold drought for at least another day. Hannah Kearney and Team USA go first and third. Jen Heil takes home the silver for Canada.
That was a really, really fun day. Those fist pumps you saw were clearly not won the gold in that moment. No score had been announced. It was just satisfaction. I had done exactly what I wanted to do, ski a good mogul run, in the moment I intended to do it. And boy, 4 years is a long time to wait for redemption. So it was just pure satisfaction of doing what I wanted to do. But now I had a problem. Well, first, this was my problem. I had had a goal, and this piece of paper was in my pocket. The reason it's all crinkled up is that you saw it was pouring rain. This piece of paper was in my pocket the day that I won a gold medal. I wrote that note to myself on the day we arrived at the Olympics for processing to get our uniforms. Seemed a little cheesy. I think the staff handed it out. I was like, just write something on this card, what you want to get out of the games. But the difference between what I wrote this time in 2010 and what I didn't write in 2006 was what I wrote, I believed. And the reason I believed it was because to me, in my mind, the data proved that I was ready to win a gold medal. And so I believed it. Anyone can write a goal down. There's studies that helps you achieve them. I don't think it does unless you believe it. And I believed in my ability to do so. So the problem that I spoke of was that I just achieved this goal. I didn't have another piece of paper with a different goal on it. This was the goal, and I didn't have another one. So do you retire? What exactly should I do? Keep skiing? I enjoyed the rest of the Olympics. The benefit of having an event on the first day of the Olympics is that you get to just be a super fan the rest of the time and go take it all in, which is a pleasure. If you're ever going to go to the Olympics, definitely have your event on the first day. But and enjoyed that. I even got to, Clive's talk inspired me, I got to throw out the first pitch for the Red Sox when I came home for the second game of the season as an honor. There's many amazing things about winning a gold medal. But that wasn't enough for me. I was starting to prepare for the finishing up this current season in 2010 after the Olympics. Yes, you get a break, but then it's back to the World Cup grind. I think we were off to Japan. And I was like, okay, got to get back in training mode. I finally watched the footage of my Olympic run from the front. Not this glorified footage you see with the from the TVs that are filming on the cables down the side of the course, but the view that the judges see. And I cringed. I saw my back flip, and I was like, that was crooked. That's not going to work for me. Okay, I'm skiing. New goals. I'm going to fix that back flip, and I'm going to become more consistent. After all, a gold medal, anyone can do that. That's one day. I want, and I wrote this one down too, world domination, period. And so I came up with a plan. I'm like, okay, jumps are my weakness. That jump is crooked. If I fix that, that will make all of my skiing better. So I'm going to do 1,000 jumps into the pool of water every season for the rest of my career, or until my backflip's perfect, one or the other. It turned out to be the former. And so here is my next version of data collection. And yes, I still have all of these sheets of paper as well. Every tally mark on this paper is a jump that I did into the water. And yes, the 1,059, 1,180, that might have been my record. I spent a lot of time trying to fix a trick that is a very small percentage of my score. And to me, it was all about becoming better at the things I was worse at. So elevating my weaknesses so that on a bad day, I still had a better performance than someone else's best performance. That was my goal. And I achieved this through those tally marks by training on the trampoline and, of course, jumping into the pool of water. And every time I climbed out of the pool dripping wet, I would move a carabiner down the chain link fence to count my jumps. I would go back to my room at the Olympic Training Center in Lake Placid, New York, and mark the tallies on a piece of paper. So I don't think those exist anywhere digitally, but I know that I did a minimum of 1,000 every year. And this was my reward. That is me, 3 years apart in the exact same location, that's the beautiful Matterhorn in the background, doing the exact same trick, and to the untrained eye, be like, that seems like a lot of effort for just doing the same trick. You didn't do anything more difficult? That's all you did? To me, that represents everything I worked so hard for. I am stronger, I am tighter, for sure my eyes are closed in this picture. I am more aware, and everything is more symmetrical. So it was totally worth the hours I put in. Probably not for the actual score improvement that I got, but for the confidence I got out of it. And as a result, I did become way more consistent because I knew I was going to land that jump no matter what and be able to ski away. So between Vancouver and Sochi, another Olympic cycle, since we're speaking in Olympic cycles, I did not do these calculations until I was preparing for this speech. This was not something I was aware of because I don't think this is motivating when you're an active athlete. But between Vancouver and Sochi, I competed in 37 competitions, and I won 27 of them, including 16 in a row. 16 in a row just takes a ton of luck, basically. And for sure it takes having elevated your weaknesses so that when you make a mistake, you can still beat people who skied the best run of their life. And that was my strategy. That was my systematic training approach that bred this confidence, which allowed me to be as successful as I was during that time period. So I went into Sochi with a goal, of course. I don't know. You know what? Now I know what the problem was. I didn't have it written on a piece of paper in my pocket. Maybe I did. My goal was to win, be the first person to win 2 gold medals in a sport that is not known for longevity. And I felt just as prepared as I did 3 years ago. 3-4 years before. The difference being, this time I was the favorite and the pressure was all on me. And in a sport with Mother Nature and a lot of elements and not a lot of chances, things happen. I landed my backflip and it was a good backflip. So my training there paid off. But I landed in this position. I should say I landed, hit a mogul, and found myself in this position. Those of you who aren't skiers, that's not what you want to look like when you're skiing anywhere, especially not in a judge sport in your Olympic run. In that moment, my heart probably dropped into my ski boots. But I pulled it back together, I made it down the course, executed another trick, and crossed the finish line. I was instantly devastated. That is not what I intended to do in the moment I intended to do it. But I was rewarded for pulling it back together with a bronze medal, which still felt like an absolute failure to me at the time. And I will get flack for that. But guess what? If you want a gold medal, a bronze medal is not as good as a gold one. And I'm wearing the number one bib because I was the number one skier in the world, and that gold medal felt like it was mine. But I didn't perform on the day. However, all of those hours of the jumps that I had done, all of the hours of training and lifting weights made me a stronger skier. 4 years before in Vancouver, if I had landed in that position, I would have fallen over. I didn't. And I made it down. And I was rewarded with a bronze medal. And I thought, I guess I'm doing something right if this awful run that felt like a failure is still rewarded with a bronze medal. So I must have been doing something right all along. Thank you, strength coaches. When I retired one season later, I competed one more year. When I retired, I competed in over 113 World Cups, 3 Olympics, many World Championships, and I felt like it achieved most of my goals. If I could only go back and get that 4.0 GPA, and if I could win another gold medal, it would have been perfect. But otherwise, I am so pleased that I had the opportunity to achieve my potential, and that's what I believe that I did in mogul skiing. Since then, I moved out to Utah. That whole time I was training in Vermont, I moved out to Utah to the ski team's headquarters. Ironically, the month that I retired, I moved to Park City. I went to school at Westminster. I got a degree in marketing. I hated marketing, so I got my personal trainer certification. I work at Athletic Republic. Their programming is really based in sports science. That's part of the reason I decided to work there. I'm serving as an ambassador, if you will, to snow sports, especially newer free skiing and freestyle sports, to the International Ski Federation. I'm on a council from 15 different countries, 15 different middle-aged white men, and by middle-aged, I mean pretty old white men, and we try to make decisions that guide snow sports into the future. I have tried many times with my spreadsheet of athlete data that I've collected, opinions from athletes, to make pie charts and graphs and present them, but once again, not everyone speaks data. And I need to get a lot better at politicking and ignore the data collection when it comes to my job at the FIS council. On the ski team, I'm working still for the ski team's foundation because with no government funding, we need a lot of money to be the best in the world, which is our ultimate goal. And I received so much support and I received so much satisfaction out of being able to try to achieve my potential that I'm trying to help the current athletes do the same thing by helping them raise money. So although none of those are full-time jobs, some of them are unpaid, some of them pay really poorly, I don't know what my future holds, but I have a feeling it will include data. Thank you very much.